Why would a diabetic want to keep or lower their A1c into the fives and under? If blood sugar levels are the single most critical measure for long-term health and life expectancy, then why would our doctors want our levels to be higher? Could this be why the American Diabetic Association still refers to diabetes as a progressive disease? If your goal is to not only improve your quality of life, but outlive your peers with no remarkable damage, then this is the episode you do not want to miss. Welcome to Resilient Diabetic. Don't forget to subscribe and hit that gray notification bell. That way, you will be alerted when new life-changing episodes have been published. And if you've learned something new today, please smash that like button for me. This is the second episode of a three-part series. The first is called What Are the True Causes of Diabetes? I'll put that link in the description box below if you missed that episode. This is where I go over why some become type 2 insulin resistant diabetics while others who eat the exact same things do not. Why someone can be overweight and or even obese yet never become diabetic, while others of normal weight, they can even have low levels of body fat yet still develop metabolic diseases like high blood pressure, heart disease, and diabetes. Why is this so important to know? If you do not understand what is happening inside your body when one becomes a diabetic, then you cannot put together a plan to finally solve and heal yourself. Today, we will cover the next important step in this process. Once one is diagnosed as a diabetic, and it does not matter the type of diabetes, why would you want to keep your A1C to around 5 and under? What are the hurdles, the misunderstandings, and the treatments your healthcare team will present? And then in the next episode, I will detail how do you easily lower and keep your A1C to 5 and under. Diabetes is a unique disease, and I have mentioned this before. Being diagnosed as a diabetic, regardless of the type, can actually be a blessing in disguise. And what do I mean by that? Unlike other diseases where you have no control over death, further complications and related diseases, that's a whole lot of suffering. Our bodies, once diagnosed, have eventually shown us our cards in life. No other disease allows for this. It's communicating back to us. We can either live a full, long, healthy life or begin this guaranteed downward spiral of extreme health issues. Everyone else will be caught off guard when it comes to their health, but your body wants to live and has sent you signs of what it wants and what is directly killing it. It has also given you this crossroads or a choice. Take it or leave it. And most importantly, it's asking you to take charge. And this is where the beauty lies. If you do take charge and understand some physiological basics, you can and will outlive your peers with no remarkable damage if caught early, because you will now have certain advantages. Everyone else may or may not be concerned with the evils of sugar-based carbs like sodas and refined packaged foods. And though yes, that is what is destroying society's health, but we also know, based on our glucose meters and our CMG meters, our continuous glucose monitor meters, that even the good carbs like oatmeal and whole wheat breads can kill us just as easily. What I realized and realized quickly once diagnosed as a late onset insulin dependent diabetic due to an autoimmune attack There is no such thing as a good carbohydrate, especially if taken in excess to one's needs. The diet you end up choosing to follow will either heal and sustain your body or literally continue destroying it at a faster rate. You will, over time, come to realize one critical overriding law. The philosopher Hippocrates could not have said it any better. And I'll quote him, "Let thy food be your medicine. Good food is medicine. Bad food will need you to take more medicine." Every processed and packaged food we eat in this modern society that comes in bags and boxes with barcodes will keep you sick, requiring more and more medicine over time. There are a couple other important physiological components every diabetic should understand, because this is where that first piece of the puzzle comes in. What are the normal blood sugar ranges for those without diabetes? Because that is our gold standard. Fasting blood sugars in the morning before eating should be between 70 to 90 milligrams a deciliter. 1 hour after meal, 90 to 130 milligrams a deciliter. 5 hours or less after eating, it should be back to that baseline of 70 to 90 milligrams a deciliter. Let me repeat this because it is so important to understand. Within 5 hours after a meal, it should be back to that baseline of 70 to 90 milligrams a deciliter. The human body contains approximately 5 liters of blood, and circulating throughout that 5 liters of blood, there are approximately only 4 grams of sugar. A healthy body only requires, and most importantly, wants less than a teaspoon of sugar at any given time floating around that entire 5 liters of blood. The human body will do everything in its power to keep blood sugars low because it becomes so toxic to cells in higher concentrations. 1 teaspoon equates to approximately 100 milligrams a deciliter on your glucose meter. 1 serving of rice, around 150 grams, is equivalent to 10 teaspoons of sugar. That healthy quote-unquote slice of whole grain wheat bread has around 6 teaspoons of sugar. Those whose blood sugars, not cholesterol levels, remain low throughout life live the longest with the least health complications. Study after study shows that for every 1% increase in the hemoglobin A1c, up the risk of death by all causes by around 24% in men and 28% for women. Nearly 3/4 of deaths comes from people with moderately elevated hemoglobin levels between 5 and 6.9. Now, what about us diabetics? And this is where the frustration begins. Our goalpost gets unjustly moved, but in the wrong direction. Depending on your doctor, your exact diagnosis, health condition, and age, they may suggest your fasting glucose levels can be as high as 130 milligrams a deciliter, and your 2-hour post-meal levels as high as 180 milligrams a deciliter or less. Type 1 diabetics such as myself that are insulin dependent generally have even higher damaging threshold levels due to fear of hypoglycemia. My endocrinologist has literal heart attacks in front of me when she sees my A1C of 5. And I will explain in a minute why you too may be scolded and lectured like a child if your A1C happens to be low and controlled. So that next question is, why would the doctors and the American Diabetes Association recommend very high blood sugars and higher than normal A1Cs, especially for us diabetics? There is one reason, and that reason is a kicker and a total letdown by our medical community. But the truth is the truth, and I'll quote the great engineer turned medical doctor, Dr. Richard Bernstein, a type 1 diabetic himself who's arguably broken more ground than anyone in history to help diabetics live normal lives. The central principle of Dr. Bernstein's solution for all of us diabetics, we have that right to normal blood sugars like every other non-diabetic would. He wants our blood sugars to remain constant and within those healthy levels. He believes in an A1C for type 1s and type 2s to be in the 4s. Yes, I said the 4s, not the mid 5s and higher. Why? Because as I've said, that is where blood sugars begin to damage the body, and you will become that statistic over time, slowly but surely. He states, the reason for the ADA standards is so that doctors can avoid the risk of that diabetic patient who could die from hypoglycemia or low blood sugars. Dr. Bernstein said, if they go low, the doctors are afraid of getting sued, so they do not want any part of it. Imagine a doctor who specializes in diabetes that has over 2,000 patients. Now, this is really important to understand. If they eventually develop neuropathy, they go blind, suffer congestive heart failure, kidney disease, kidney dialysis, or their legs get amputated, well, then that is expected and a natural consequence of having diabetes. If that patient suffers these diabetic complications with blood sugars in the ADA's target range, then the long-term consequences of their disease could never justify a lawsuit. And this is why the ADA calls diabetes and treats diabetes as a progressive disease. Now, if a patient out of the 2,000 dies from hypoglycemia, then that doctor can get sued. For example, they may get into a fatal car accident because they've passed out. So, for safety margins, they are not going to allow their patients to be anywhere near normal blood sugars because of the risk of hypoglycemia gets far too great. To hedge their practices and the organizations as a whole, they would want your blood sugars to be 2 or 3 times what is normal. The bottom line, it's not about you living a life free of complications and great health per se, but about the survival and profitability of their business models and institutions. Second, as you are now aware, why? Because you're subscribed to this great channel, doctors are not nutritionalists. Diabetes is a disease of the diet. They, for the most part, have not had a single nutrition course during the entire stint in medical schools. Doctors and their nutritionalists have to adhere to the guidelines set by the health institutions in conjunction to the food manufacturers, mind you, for the basic high carbohydrate, low fat, low protein food guide pyramid diet protocol. Thus, we as diabetics are encouraged to eat cleaner, more wholesome carbs at every meal, including breads, starches, fruits, snacks. We are to substitute, say, brown bread instead of white bread, replace sodas with smoothies, oatmeal for cereals. But as you know, a carb is a carb regardless, especially to that overworked pancreas, or in my case, a non-existing pancreas due to that late onset autoimmune attack, which made me that insulin-dependent type 1 diabetic. What's worse, the only way they've been taught to treat diabetes is with medications and more medications, like these new heavy-duty, fast-acting insulins, 3 to 4 times more powerful than regular insulin. And what do I use to keep my blood sugars flat and controlled? Regular insulin. Here is my continuous glucose meter reading as of this morning. You see, these industrial strength insulins are designed for that modern lifestyle of eating highly refined, carb-based, packaged foods. The results? Violent whiplashing of one's blood sugars up and down like a roller coaster, making it impossible to maintain low and controlled flatline blood sugars. The violent swings in blood sugars not only impact life expectancy, but your day-to-day experiences, the mood swings, the hunger, work productivity losses, relationship issues, depression, to even one's sexual health and drive. It becomes devastating. So if you are ever eventually put on these powerful insulins, metformin, and the host of all brand new medications, and you're still eating a diet high in carbohydrates, then yes, your doctor is right. You will not be able to keep your A1C in those lower ranges safely. You must then keep your A1C in those higher ranges, but then that too, as you know, will lead to guaranteed devastating health outcomes. But fear not, according to our healthcare experts, everything is treatable with more and more medications. Always remember the final rule: the right foods are medicine. The next question, what are the right foods? Stay tuned to that next episode. Also, maintaining and keeping your muscle tissue is that single critical task we as diabetics have towards normalizing and controlling our blood sugars. This also leads to living that long, independent life free of complications. And that's all done by eating the right amounts of the most important macronutrient in your diet, protein. So I bet many of you have many additional questions like, how much protein would a diabetic need per day? What are the best kinds of protein? I'll set up a playlist for you with all the answers to those questions. And I'll even expose more deceit and misunderstandings doctors and nutritionists are still taught to this very day about this vital macronutrient, protein. The first thing you will see is to subscribe to this all-important life-changing channel. The second is the link to the playlist on protein. So have a great and productive day, and we will see you soon with another new episode, which are generally released bi-monthly. Bye for now.